Okay, great. That's fine over there.
Just fine, how about that?
Hi.
Hi.
How's it going, man?
How you doing, old man?
I'm here.
I like your shirt.
Yes, sir.
I love these.
You look like you're gonna wear the heck out of it right now, because I'm the vice president. Proud of it. When I was working at the fair, people wanted to get their pictures taken with you. They didn't feel good.
That's where that underground street picture goes under, cut off, goes out.
Evening, David.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you all for coming. I'm very glad to have you here. My name is Sarah Hughes, and I'm part of the leadership here of the Forsyth County Tea Party, and I'm just filling in for tonight. Let's start with the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Can everybody hear me?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Well.
Normally we have somebody say a prayer. Does anybody want to volunteer for that?
I'll say a prayer. God.
Thank you, Sheri.
You can't be too embarrassed to pray.
All right. Do you mind doing the traditional we'll rise and we'll pray together? Dear Lord, we come to you together today. We ask that you will watch over us, watch over the words that we say and the words that we hear. Help us, Lord, to bring everything to glory to you. And we just ask that you watch over the proceedings. Amen.
Amen.
Thank
you. All right. Has everybody signed in your sign-in sheet? If not, I can get that started, pass around, and hand it to whoever needs it. Do we have any new guests in the room? Anybody who's never been here? Well, thank you all for coming. And do we have any sort of public officials or candidates today? So, I know we have Sheri Gilligan. All right, she's our only one today. November, we are having our election. So if you are a voting member, you can sign up and run for a position. We have a chair, vice chair, secretary, and treasurer. And Sheri has brought also the raffle. Yay.
Yes. I didn't bring the gun.
With no gun.
I brought the picture of the gun.
Okay.
So it's a 9mm Springfield. It does come with two 19 round magazines. So if you're interested, these are the raffle tickets. You can get one raffle ticket for five, or you can get five raffle tickets for 20, and I understand this one right here is the winning ticket. You just don't know which one I touched. So be sure to get your ticket before you walk out the door.
Thank you.
I'm going to have to run away.
That's fine. We also have a donation jar that we pass around to, so your donations are greatly appreciated. We're going to go ahead and get started. We have a guest speaker today, Tony West of Americans for Prosperity. He's here today. Tony, thank you for coming.
Absolutely. Sarah, just had to announce, I bought some Trump stuff for anybody who supports Mr. Trump.
have some stuff over there on the table, you know, stickers and like that, door sign, so please take whatever you want.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hey, good evening, everybody. As Sarah introduced me, I'm Tony West. I'm the grassroots director for Americans for Prosperity, Georgia. If you aren't familiar with our organization, we are the largest conservative grassroots organization in the country. We exist to recruit, educate, and then mobilize citizens like yourselves in support of the policies of a free society. And I think that's why we're all here, because we support a free society unburdened by the government, especially the federal government. I asked Sarah and Dan if I could come speak tonight is in regards to something that's going to happen in about 3 weeks, you know, the election. We aren't an election organization per se. We're more focused on policy. But when you have, you know, 33 Senate races going on, a presidential election, it's hard not to end up involved somehow. What we've been doing the past few months is contacting swing voters, those voters that don't necessarily have a political ideology the way we all do. They kind of swing back and forth from election to election. And we've been contacting them and letting them know the record of the progressive liberal in that Senate race. So we're talking Wisconsin, Ohio, North Carolina, Florida, all of these states with very close Senate races, with the balance of power in the Senate hanging in the balance. We've been contacting millions of people over the last few months, and we have reached that time where we've done just about all the persuading we can do, and now it's what I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with, get out the vote time. And we as an organization can only be as successful as far as our staff can get. What they always tell us, and I say they as in our organization's leadership, is we don't have the money to beat the left by just hiring people. It takes the grassroots coming through, putting into action what we believe in to get the job done. So I asked Dan and Sarah to come here really briefly and tell you what we've been up to and ask for your help. We do door-to-door and we do phone banking. I haven't had a Saturday off and I don't know how long, but it's been good because we're making a difference, and I'm getting to enjoy it with folks like you who agree with us, who are trying to retain a policy majority in the Senate, which, like I said, is in danger, unfortunately. We have an office, a field office by the Mall of Georgia, so it's a little bit of a drive for y'all. We've been calling every Saturday. We pretty much call all day Friday as well. But what I've been telling everybody, anybody who says, hey, Tony, I'm interested, but my schedule isn't allowing me, I'm going to come to you. I'm headed down to Decatur Thursday for a lady who's been wanting to call because she's really interested in the Florida race, but she can't get up here. So I'm going to drive. We do everything on iPads. I don't know if y'all are very familiar with that technology. I know a lot of people are doing the paper lists where you're actually dialing. You have to dial 9 numbers every time. Ours is an automatic dialer, 200 attempts per hour. It's pretty amazing. That's why I think we are the most effective at doing this. But I just wanted to let everyone know what we're doing. 8 Senate races we're involved in. We're moving the needle really in a really big way, in my opinion. And these last 3 weeks, we're just trying to get all hands on deck, get us across the finish line, make that final difference, put your beliefs into action with us, with our technology. I'm happy to meet anybody at the office, but I'd like to let you know I will come to you. I have the iPads outside right now. I'm willing to stay 30 minutes just to show you what we do, just to show you what it looks like. So I'm really glad to be here. That's really all I have. I'll take a question, but I know I'm not the main speaker. All right, don't hesitate to come get me if you want to see the iPads, make a few calls. We're trying to defeat Patrick Murphy. He's running against Rubio in the calls we're doing tonight. Thanks.
All right, thank you, Tony. Our next guest speaker is Dr. Tina Trent. She has done a lot of good work here the past several years. She got her doctorate from the Institute of Women's Studies at Emory University, and she has also spent more than a decade in Atlanta's worst neighborhoods, helping troubled families and crime victims and discovering firsthand the destruction that's caused by poverty industries. Today she's going to be talking about George Soros and the dismantling of America.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now I can, do you mind if somebody sits there and flips the, I'd appreciate that. I can go on about George Soros for hours, so I don't know how long your speakers usually speak at these events, but so what I'm just doing is I'm front loading the stuff that I think is most relevant right now, and I'm always happy to come back and do some more, another presentation about Soros, because he really unfortunately is somebody who we have, you know, an unlimited amount of information about. And if you could go to the first slide, this is my incredibly long introduction. How George Soros and his open society institutes threaten our justice system, our elections, and our nation's legal sovereignty while funding the war on cops. And we could just all stop there and go home, but I'll try to fill some of those things in for you tonight. I wanted to tell you a little bit about myself and my personal journey. I used to be a Democratic lobbyist in the state of Georgia. And I have changed. I grew up in Poughkeepsie, New York, which is, if people know Poughkeepsie, they know it's an IBM town. Everybody worked at, you know, the whistle blew, everybody drove to the factory, worked there, the whistle blew at 5 o'clock. It was just like The Simpsons, and everyone drove home at the same time and mowed their lawns, and it was a really wonderful middle class. It's what we're losing in America today. My parents voted Democrat. Most of the people we knew voted Democrat. They weren't very political people. Somehow I ended up with an older brother who became a John Birch member at the age of 13. And none of us in the family knew how that happened, but I've apologized to him since then for being right about everything when he was 13 and I was 12. And not everybody can do that with their siblings, so I was lucky to at least be able to have the chance. I grew up in the 70s, and I grew up as a fairly typical, you know, centrist liberal girl who wanted to go out into the world and do good and work in social justice and help the poor. And it wasn't something I put a lot of thought into, but it was something that I put a lot of heart into. And after college, I was driving to, I became a VISTA volunteer, which is, sometimes it's called the Domestic Peace Corps. It's a radical leftist organization, far more leftist than I realized. I was an issues person. I wanted to work with crime victims. I wanted to work with child molestation victims and rape victims. And so I got a VISTA job up in Tennessee, and then my car died under a bridge in downtown Atlanta in the middle of the night, and I was in Atlanta for the next 20 years, about a mile from that bridge. I just got sucked into a vortex, and I've been here ever since. I've taken a few trips back to Florida over the years, but my husband and I, you know, had to come back here for his law practice, and just a few weeks ago we moved to Forsyth County, so I hope I'll be seeing a lot more of the people in this room, because I'm now in the county with the rest of you, although I'm finding farm life to be harder than I had expected it to be. So right after college, I actually went to work for VISTA in Atlanta. I spent 10 years on the left. Because I worked with crime victims, I was kind of a center-left person. I mean, I hated the ACLU from the day that I knew about their existence. So I never fit in the left, but I honestly didn't know any Republicans or conservatives. And I just, there were social forces. I'm not taking responsibility for my own choices, but there were so many social forces around me in school and in the community and in politics that made me feel like I was doing the right thing by lobbying for pro-choice issues at the state legislature. I was the executive director of Georgians for Choice, which meant that I supervised 45 pro-choice organizations and coordinated their lobbying. I did refugee resettlement in Clarkston, Georgia. I worked at Morehouse University for somebody who was stealing an enormous amount of money from the federal government. I turned him in, and they did nothing. I turned in my next boss in VISTA for misusing grant money, and they did nothing. And every step of the way, I'm really glad I had these experiences on the left, but every step of the way, I was dabbling in all the organizations and the types of organizations that George Soros funds. And I, everywhere I went, not only did I see out-and-out corruption, but I also began to really seriously question what I was doing to our clients' lives. I worked with crime victims. I worked with grandmothers who were raising their great-grandkids in the projects in Atlanta. And I was raised with enough of a work ethic and decent parents to realize and see with my own eyes that what I was actually doing was hurting the people I thought we were helping. But it was a very good experience for me in that, and I still do crime victim advocacy and lobbying. It was a very good experience for me because I was there on the ground when George Soros started the Open Society Foundations in America. I was actually working, and I was going to graduate school and working for Georgians for Choice, and I was put, the people for the American Way came, and they organized all of the left-wing and Democratic lobbyists together. They put us through massive trainings. They convinced the environmentalists to sit down with the labor union guys, which wasn't happening before. They got the SEIU workers organizing other people in their workplaces. And so I was actually there in those rooms when George Soros was beginning to impact our political system and in fact our entire nation. Okay, so by 1999, I was thrown out of Democratic politics. I opposed the hate crimes bill in the state of Georgia. Thanks in part to my opposition, we're the only state that has no hate crimes law. And I did that as a crime victims advocate because I believe those laws would politicize the justice system, and they certainly have, and they're just being used as a weapon against conservatives. And I wasn't a conservative back then, but I just felt like they were just unfair, and they would create different levels of people with different levels of rights. And it turns out I was more right than I thought. So I was thrown out of I was literally thrown out of politics. I lost my job. I lost my academic teaching, teacher training at Emory University when I published an editorial that was used to kill the bill. And I began my long journey to the right. And I wanted to give you that background because I personally, you know, discovered George Soros back in 1996. I had spent 1986 to 1996 working as a volunteer advocate for crime victims, trying to pass bills like three strikes and you're out in Florida and Georgia, recidivist enhancement sentencing, truth in sentencing, and laws like that. And I was working with, you know, that we were taking our lead from Giuliani in New York. And he was really sort of inspiring district attorneys around the country. Even Charlie Crist in Florida, who later became very problematic politically, was very good on these issues at the time. And we helped pass a lot of laws that helped put a lot of really bad, recidivist, violent people away. But by 1999, as I was leaving or being kicked out of the Democratic Party, I began to see that there was a real coordinated effort to roll back the accomplishments that we've made in crime advocacy. And that was my introduction to George Soros. A couple of years later, Cliff Kincaid called me up. He'd seen my blog. Cliff runs America's Survival in Washington, D.C. He's also the lead editor at Accuracy in Media. And he and I have a new booklet out about radicalism in higher education. And he asked me if I wanted to join Trevor Loudon and start working on something called the Soros Files, and I said absolutely, because I have just been sitting in my own house for the last couple of years since I got kicked out of the Democratic Party, doing nothing but kind of like fuming and researching these people. And all the signs led back to Soros. So Trevor and I put together the first database we had of these organizations. And even though I was somebody who had been on the ground in 1996 when People for the American Way started training all the left-wing activists to come together, the several years that had gone by had enhanced this activity, and I found that it was all being run by George Soros. That he was basically funding all of these different efforts to create what I call activist silos. You had the communists and the old school communists and socialists and the red group. You had all the labor unions, and then you had the SEIU, who was organizing government employees. You had all the feminists and the pro-abortion industry. You had the environmentalists, and you had the labor unions, and they never got along before. The environmentalists and the labor unions didn't like each other. But they realized at that point that they had common ground, and that they were going to, that if they could actually find a way to coalesce all of these efforts, then they could basically steal America. And when I came back and started looking at it for Cliff Kincaid, the level of organization that had taken place had blown my mind. You know, people I knew in Atlanta who used to just pocket a few block grants, you know, back in the Clinton years, and then walk away with them, and, you know, and they were supposed to be doing poverty work and helping people improve their lives. All of a sudden, these folks were awash in money. I mean, 10 times the money that they had before. And a lot of it was still tax money. But behind all of that, there was a lot of coordination happening through open society foundations to do these public-private partnerships, and that's where we really lost our way as a country. And it's been 20 years this year since George Soros decided that he was going to start focusing his activities on America. And I think that we can pretty much look at those 20 years and say, all the roads for what's gone wrong lead back to this man. Okay. You can go to the next one. Yeah. Who is George? Can I pull this up so I can see this? Okay. Who is George Soros? I'm guessing most people in this room know who George Soros is. If I could see hands, I mean, you know a lot about him already. What you may not know is that in 2008 he really was able to supercharge his pet issues with the recovery money. I mean, that was the moment and the place and the time where he went from the efforts he'd been building since 1996 to really picking the taxpayer's pocket. And that I will get to in a few more minutes. But who is George Soros, the man? I say it transparency for thee, but not for me, because the way he's lived his life is to make tremendous demands on governments and peoples and elected officials that they behave in ways that he doesn't, hold his own behavior to the same standard. So he was born in Budapest, Hungary in 1930. Right now he's in the process of attacking the current Hungarian premier, Viktor Orban. Because Orban is one of the few European leaders who has closed his borders and says he does not want to take Syrian refugees in. He doesn't want to take, you know, tens or hundreds of thousands of young men into his country. So Soros is engaging in an all-out ground war against the Hungarian premier because it's one of the few countries in Europe that's actually standing up to what's going on there. And one of his famous quotes is, Soros's famous quotes is, "National borders are the real enemy." He says that. So in 1947, after the war, he of course was a Nazi collaborator during the war. He was a young teenager. Had he come out afterwards and said he was coerced, that would be one thing, because it would be a life and death situation for him. But unlike all the other people who were forced in collaboration, he speaks fondly of it. He's a Jew. In 1947, he was able to go to England after the war, and the English people paid for his education, and in return, he destroyed their economic system decades later. In 1957, and I can't explain any of this psychologically, you know, I mean, there's a lot of theories out there, but he's just a very evil man. I think that's the easiest way to describe it. In 1957, he moved to America, but unlike most of the people who are relocating to America, either as refugees, post-war refugees, some of them, or as business people, would come to America, set up their businesses here, become citizens. Quite tellingly, he didn't become a citizen. In 1967, he started moving his financial services industry offshore. In 1988, France finally managed to convict him of insider trading. But by 1992, which is an event that's called Black Wednesday, he created a situation where the British pound collapsed. And in one day, he made $10 billion. And the British economy never really recovered. He's done the same thing in other places too. In 1996, he opened Open Societies in America, which was the beginning of his big network of nonprofits. In 2011, this is really ironic, he closed his mutual fund in America because he had some of his organizations, including the Sunshine Foundation, had sued requiring certain types of financial disclosures for certain types of financial transactions, and he did not want to have to abide by them, and he was wealthy enough by then to, you know, to be able to move his money elsewhere. So once he helped pass this law that required other people to disclose financial transactions, he wouldn't disclose them, so he shut his services down. As of today, he's worth $25 billion. But what does open society mean? George Soros says that he bases open society on Karl Popper's philosophy. Now, I'm a very quotidian, simple-minded, nuts and bolts kind of person. I don't do philosophy. I don't do big issues. I don't even like look at the sky. I'm a small, organized thinker. So I can't really explain to you the ins and outs of the open society philosophy. But as a political movement, Karl Popper was somebody who, you know, started out as a Marxist, actually was disturbed by some Marxist violence he had seen and abandoned it more or less for some version of social democracy. He was Austrian-British. And his idea was to create parallel nonprofit organizations that would keep governments in check. And that sounds wonderful because we all are dedicated to keeping government in check, right? I mean, that's a goal that we have too. But his idea was really to remove the rights of the citizens of the country and pass them over to small groups of intellectuals in the universities he controlled, in the nonprofits he controlled. And you know, we can see this happening in America every day now. He believed in the theory that small groups of enlightened people, you know, would know better than the lumpen proletariat, the bourgeoisie scum, and you know, all of the people that we are, the despicables. The despicables. Oh, I'm sorry, the deplorables. I apologize. The two ironies about Karl Popper, and Karl Popper did inspire Soros, and this is a weird thing I keep trying to figure out. He shared an interest with Bill Ayers. They were both kindergarten teachers. They were both fascinated by early childhood education. And in Bill Ayers' case, it's a very disturbing thing. But he was a psychologist, and they both realized, these political activists both realized that the way that you actually transform society is you start with the age of 1 to 5, and that's where you get them. So it's also ironic that Soros is his acolyte because he doesn't agree. I think if Karl Popper was alive today, he wouldn't be very happy about that. So the first thing that Soros did was he began opening these nonprofits in Eastern Europe, and he opened an enormous university there, and his ambition was to create a European Union because he's very opposed to national borders. And he knows that the further you take government away from people, the less access people have to controlling the government. So he did a lot of work. Once the Soviet Union pulled away from Eastern Europe, he moved in there, and that was where he began his first empire. Then he tried to move into Russia and China, both of which said, get lost, because they were totalitarian states and are totalitarian states, and they didn't want to share their power. They took a look at him and they said, you know, no, our dictators don't want you to come in and take away the power of the dictators. I think one of the things that's been harmful for us is that our very openness has enabled Soros to do his work here. Once he wasn't able to start up projects in Russia and China, he started focusing on America as his next target. The first person that helped him run the Open Society Foundation was Ari Nair, who was the head of the ACLU at the time. And so their big focus from the very beginning has always been anti-law, anti-law enforcement, anti-police. I mean, that's been a huge focus of all their groups, and that's kind of the nexus of their values. Merton Halperin was the second person to run Open Society's Foundation. And then right now, Christopher Stone is in charge of it. People sometimes say to me, well, won't Soros die soon? And, you know, maybe, I don't know. He's really old, but that's not going to change anything except that it would probably dump billions and billions and billions of dollars more into his movements. He's got his people lined up to run it after his death. So that's not something that's going to be a solution. Christopher Stone is a British criminologist who believes in the empty. He's very dedicated to the empty the prisons movement. He doesn't believe any criminal should go to prison, and he's in charge of this entire effort. Okay. The Open Society pyramid of organizations is controlling America from the top down. Soros funds literally hundreds of organizations. He also funds literally thousands of academic positions. He, during the last 20 years, he has provided fellowships and created teaching positions at universities throughout America. And so in addition to, and he brought a great many people over from the Middle East. He funded a whole lot of Middle East scholarships. And really, we began to, prior to him doing this, if you were in a Middle East studies department in America, chances were that the primary scholars there were pro-Israel. Through his efforts, that has been completely devastated, and now most Middle Eastern studies programs in America, and in fact most of higher education, is an openly hostile place to Jews. So there are things that Soros has done that are not just, that are not merely starting organizations or funding, you know, union efforts, but he also focused on the educational system because he knew perfectly well that once you own the universities, you know, you own every advanced job in that society. Goals of the Open Society, and there's a couple different names, Open Society Foundations, Open Society Institutes, we'll just call it Open Society. The international goals, the most important ones, are global taxation for the Millennium Promise, which is an effort that's been going on for several years to basically tax us to redistribute money to the world. Soros put $500 million into trying to pass the Millennium Promise. It will cost the American taxpayers $800 billion. So it includes, and they've made a great deal of progress on this this plan. Some of the people who have been involved in it are Bill Gates, Harold Coe from the U.S. State Department, of course Ralph Nader, Al Gore, Pope Benedict, and everybody else associated with this type of globalist movement. Pretty much the Clinton Foundation in toto is involved as well. And this is something. This is the kind of thing you don't see in the headlines that much, but it could be one of the most toxic and dangerous things that are happening, because as you know, as we move towards, I feel that if we lose this election, we're going to end up having the United Nations be superpowered and have a lot more influence over what happens on our shores. One of the things that he's worked on a lot is to create laws in the United Nations that would actually have sovereignty in the United States. And you know, some of this is Sharia law stuff, because of course he supports the Sharia law efforts because they're disruptive, even though they allegedly go against all of the values he claims to stand for in terms of personal freedom. But he has also worked, his organizations have also gotten certain cities like Chicago to sign on to certain United Nations oversight for some of their criminal justice work. So, It's unconstitutional, it's illegal, but they managed to pass in a couple of, I know they've done it in Chicago, I know they've done something in New York City under de Blasio, but they're using United Nations law in the United States. And they're not doing it from the top down. This isn't the federal government doing it, this is local governments doing it, and they're getting guidance. Undermining defense and security, of course, and legalizing drugs and opening our borders. These are the main goals. The national goals of the Open Society is to legalize drugs and enter the prisons, abortion rights, and he's probably the primary funder for the euthanasia movement, socialized medicine, of course, and to grow government spending. There's also local effects, and when I say local, I mean state right down to county effects of the Open Society's foundation's programs. They're, of course, empowering unions and environmentalists to influence our state and local laws. The entire Agenda 21 sustainability movement is funded by him through dozens of organizations, and even up here, I mean, even in places of the most conservative parts of the country, our legislators are getting tremendous pressure to get in line behind all of this. Okay. The strategy of the Open Society Foundation, I think, is something that's very important to think about, because whether they're doing something that has to do with labor organizing or organizing crowds of thugs to attack Trump supporters or getting into school systems or opening our borders, they always do it in four steps. They declare that they're working on behalf of human rights. They work to deny the legitimacy of United States institutions, like, for example, our border. They disrupt legislating and law enforcement, and that's the kind of muscle arm of this movement. That's the Occupy people, that's Blood Not Bombs, which is another group that you may not have heard of, but was funded by Soros during the same time that Occupy was around. And now they're pouring all their money into Black Lives Matters. And then the other thing he does, which is something that he's been very successful in New York State, but also in other states, is defunding state and local taxation systems with excessive demands. Okay. The shadow party. This is a term that David Horowitz came up with, and David Horowitz, if you go to the Discovering the Network site, David Horowitz has more information about Soros than anybody else, besides my boss, Cliff Kincaid, who also has something called the Soros Files. Our files are a little bit out of date, so are theirs, but there's a lot of information on there, and it does get updated occasionally. Soros started working with the Democratic Party in the 1990s, and as I said, he started churning out these organizations, America Coming Together, MoveOn.org, Center for American Progress, and funding the lobbies for labor, environmental, feminist, immigration, and poverty politics. And he is really the person who put the first push of money behind Obama. He was working with the Clintons. He went and worked with Obama, and now he's back to working with Hillary Clinton. I was interested in what he was doing in the state of Georgia during elections. And there have been there's been a spate of articles about his activism in Henry County. And I'm not 100% sure where Henry County is. I was in downtown Atlanta for 20 years, so I was in Fulton County, and then I was in Dahlonega for a couple of years.
Henry County, south of Atlanta. My daughter lives in Henry County, and she said Soros, the Republican dropped out.
Yes.
Soros was funding the Democrat.
Yeah, he gave $100,000 to the Democrat, so you guys know about that. That's the latest, I mean, that's what we know. The other thing he did was he's given at least $1.1 million to the Democrat minority whip, Stacey Abrams, to run voter registration projects in the state of Georgia. They haven't been very successful. I think her own party's mad at her, but $1.1 million is still an awful lot of money to have on the ground. And when you think about the number of people that they can hire and what they can do, knocking on doors with that kind of money in one state, with one state legislator, we don't have anything of comparable size on our side. And, until recently, we weren't even really considered a swing state. So as we get closer to being a swing state, demographically and politically, we're going to see a lot more of that money coming into here. Ari Mayer said, these questions pretty much speak for themselves. The main obstacle to a stable and just world order is the United States. I mean, this is one of the most powerful people in America, and this is what he thinks of us. Okay. The Open Society Agenda. Okay, UN law over US law and opposing American security. These are the organizations, in essence, these are the large organizations, in essence, that he funds to do a number of things. The Center for Constitutional Rights has been around for a couple of decades, but he now pays for it. The Center for International Policy, National Security Archive, Human Rights Watch, ACLU. These are the groups that are actually working to make sure that we don't have international, that hinder our efforts to protect our soldiers, to protect our efforts overseas, and to protect the information we need to keep a secret in this country in order to have a viable defense. The open borders activism is interesting, and I'm sorry, my notes are a little bit out of order since I just unpacked all this stuff from a box after looking for it for 3 days. Let's see. Okay. Open borders has been, I would say, George Soros's one of his three primary goals since the 90s here. And he, of course, couldn't create a European Union here. He just wanted to open our borders, and he still does. The Emma Lazarus Fund was one of the first groups that he put a lot of money into. This was back when Gingrich and Clinton were actually, Gingrich and the Republican Revolution was pushing for welfare reform. I was still on the left at the time, and I thought welfare reform was wonderful. Everybody else around me thought that Bill Clinton had become the devil because they were pushing to get people off welfare, and that was just completely unacceptable in the circles that I moved in. But the Emma Lazarus Fund, what was the organization that came in and said, illegal immigrants, we have to find ways to fund illegal immigrants and make sure they have access to welfare too. And that was their primary goal. And the way they've done it, for the most part, they're not all that active anymore, but the way they've done it for the most part is by providing block grants to universities and researchers and county health departments so that they can actually funnel money through those different entities in order to provide welfare services, even if the law says, and the laws that we pass say, that people who are here illegally don't have a right to those things. LaRaza is the radical open borders group. MALDEF is another one. Casa de Maryland is another one. That there's a wonderful report on Casa de Maryland that I highly recommend. It's by somebody called Jim Simpson. He's a writing partner of mine. He also works for Cliff Kincaid. And Casa de Maryland shows how they took a small group of activists in one state, Maryland, and using their national resources and using their ties to the media and the fact that Maryland is a liberal state, they created a situation where illegal immigration in Maryland exploded. And they've used the template of what they did in Maryland and other states, and Georgia is in those crosshairs. Civil rights groups accusing Americans of hatred. This is another thing that Soros has been funding for decades. The ACLU, of course, is involved in a lot of this. The Arab American Institute and the Center for Constitutional Rights. The NAACP, the MALDEF and LaRaza are the immigration groups. And then the Leadership Council on Civil and Human Rights is one of their big siloed groups of organizations. And they've got hundreds of organizations working together. A lot of the people in that coalition are tenured professors in the universities, and so this is a lot of the ways that freedom of speech has been shut down on university campuses. Taking over the judiciary, are there any lawyers in the room? You don't have to raise your hands. Okay. A number of years ago, George Soros began donating a bunch of money to the American Bar Association. Because it is a nonprofit, and every attorney, like my husband, has to belong to the ABA. Has to pay dues to the state one. We're required, to pay a couple $100 a year in every state he practices in, and the American Bar Association has become increasingly radicalized because of programs that Soros has fed into this organization. So if you are an attorney, it's got to be really chafing to sit around and think about the fact that you have to belong to this professional organization. It guides your profession. And if you look at the Soros-funded projects within it, they're radical leftist programs, but you have no choice. If you want to practice law in the United States, you have to be part of this. The League of Women Voters, he did the same thing. And the League of Women Voters always was a liberal organization, at least in the last maybe 30 years. When I was at Georgians for Choice as their executive director, League of Women Voters belonged to Georgians for Choice, and I would always wonder, how did the League of Women Voters belong to a partisan abortion group? Even when I believed in abortion rights, it seemed strange to me that we had, people who were supposed to be, who have been given tremendous power over the way that states register people to vote, and they were taking a stand on a partisan issue like that. has also gone into the law schools, and he created a network between the American Bar Association, the League of Women Voters, a whole bunch of law professors from New York University, Georgetown University, and virtually every other prestigious law school in the United States. And what they work to do, what they've been working to do, is what they call merit selection for judges instead of electing judges. And the American Bar Association is now completely behind this. This is a very, very dangerous, dangerous thing, because they're saying that they want the ABA to be the people who decide who your judges are, rather than us voting on them. And they've, of course, produced mountains, oceans of scholarship arguing that that this is, creates a better class of judges because they know more than the, you know, unwashed, deplorable judges that we sometimes elect by accident. Crime and punishment. These are really where the issues are very important to me. He of course funds anti-death penalty stuff. He has been successful in rolling back life without parole for juvenile offenders. Now that may sound like something that people could get behind, but very, very, very few people under the age of 18 commit enough heinous murders to get life without parole. And those that do are generally people who are the most terrifying people in society. State by state, they're knocking down the life without parole laws that we helped strengthen back in the early 90s. And I don't know if anybody else is from the New York or New Jersey area, or from Chicago here. I mean, I'm from upstate New York, but I remember New York City in the early 90s, it was a bloodbath. Chicago this year is on track for exceeding their 1991 murder rate. Okay, so we have gone full circle in just 20 years. And the good work that Giuliani did in New York City is, of course, being taken apart piece by piece. And the thousands and thousands, tens of thousands of lives of young urban kids in trouble that were saved by these laws that we passed are gonna be lost in this generation. The Open Society Foundation supports full legalization of all drugs. That is one of their goals. And Soros has put a tremendous amount of money into that. Ending mandatory minimum sentencing, and something called Ban the Box, and of course, prisoners' rights. Ban the Box is interesting because it is one of those stealth, is anybody here familiar with Ban the Box, the movement? Okay, I need to drink something because my mouth is really dry.
Ban the Box is a movement that our own governor has taken a lead in,
which makes it illegal for employers to actually ask about people's criminal histories when they're hiring them. It's you ban the box.
The box.
The box you have to check when you're applying for a job. And what they and it's a very cleverly it's worth focusing on this for just a minute, because it's a very cleverly designed movement. And by the way, it's being supported by a bunch of libertarian groups and Republican and prestigious Republicans as well. And in this state is taking a lead on that. Ban the Box, it's a two-step process. And what they said, the way they wrote the law is very clever because it helps maximize lawsuits. It says that, say, Home Depot doesn't get to ask somebody if they have a felony conviction when they first apply for a job. When they come in to interview, then before they get hired, they can be asked. But the way, if anybody's in human resources, you can imagine the kind of problems this creates. Because then, if you're in human resources, and you're somebody who is sitting in Home Depot hiring people, and you find out that you've got two job candidates, and one of them has a criminal history, and one of them doesn't, and you didn't know before you had got them in the door, they've got their foot in the door. And people who've kept out of trouble, you know, can't sue Home Depot for not hiring them. But people who do have criminal records that get exposed at that point, once they've been interviewed, you know, they've got armies of lawyers set up in order to sue these companies. And most big companies in the states where this is being enacted, and we are one of them, they are pushing for this. Our Governor Deal has taken a national lead on this. One of the things that's happening is that proactively the human resources departments are changing their policies because they're terrified of being sued. And of course, they're targeting the big industries, the big companies, the people who hire a lot of people. So That includes people like Home Depot who could come into your home, you know, and we no longer have the right to know, perhaps, what their criminal history is. So you hire someone to come in, Home Depot may have felt pressured to hire that person. And I don't mean to keep mentioning Home Depot because they're particularly unusual, but they make a good example of how toxic and damaging this can be. Of course, the Band the Box people have certain rules. You know, bus drivers and school teachers are excluded. Sex offenders have to admit that they're sex offenders. But the idea is to put so much pressure on these on the big companies that they change their hiring rules in favor of criminals. The Drug Policy Alliance is, so it was for a long time Soros's most effective campaign. And I did a report on it. You can find it at America's Survival. It's called Narco State California. Soros began pouring hundreds of millions of dollars into legalizing all drugs back as early as the mid-1990s. And I don't know how much money he's put into it because he does it through so many different organizations. But we're not just talking about pot. Okay, we're talking about cocaine, we're talking about meth, we're talking about prescription drugs that are now restricted. They target California first because California has propositions where they can actually, people can individually vote. And so the first law that they passed in 1996, the Drug Policy Alliance, was Proposition 215 for medical marijuana. Then Colorado and some other states started trying to pass these laws, and they set up different types of laws for marijuana. But a really interesting thing happened on the way to the pot festival. Californians, witnessing what was happening with medical marijuana, actually shot down Soros' next proposition, which was Proposition 19. And Proposition 19 was going to say that all pot use was okay, not just the system that was set up for quote-unquote medical marijuana use. So he lost the second referendum. When he lost that second referendum, he got together with George Shultz, who's been leading his, yes, that George Shultz, who has been helping lead his efforts to legalize all drugs. And they went to the UN and they formed a coalition there. Soros gave $16.5 million to start this coalition. He works with Jody Evans, he worked with Chavez. They set up the Global Commission on Drug Policy in Brazil, and they've begun working through the United Nations to make their way back into the United States and affect this policy. And so they got a lot of dictators from South America together to start working on legalizing drugs in America. I don't think I need to explain to you why. But when people in California saw what this particular policy was doing to California, and especially to daily pot use by children under the age of 18, skyrocketed. And it's skyrocketed in Colorado now, they pushed back and they said, we don't want any more. And that was a tremendous loss for him. Okay, increasing government dependency. I want to just tell you one story here about something called the Robin Hood Foundation. And they think this is funny, the Robin Hood Foundation. But the Robin Hood Foundation is a New York State-based foundation where the rich steal from the middle class and give it to the poor. Okay? And so they even call it the Robin Hood Foundation. It was a bunch of people who made a whole bunch of money on the stock market and got together with Bloomberg in order to, you know, create, they wanted to have, one of their big programs was to have all solar power in the schools in New York City, and there was going to be a garden on the roof of each school, and, you know, just really crazy, outrageous, outlandish ways of spending money. But the way that they were funding it, and this is really the template for the way Soros operates, is he threw a couple million, tens of millions of dollars at this and helped push through laws that required New York taxpayers to subsidize the vast majority of the program. And so these venture capitalists and Soros put up a little bit of seed money. And then the taxpayers, you know, I mean, the city council up there is just so insanely left-wing, it's unbelievable. Wiener was the most conservative person who had a chance to win that race. Seriously. I mean, setting aside his other obvious problems, Wiener was actually the the most likely conservative choice compared to de Blasio in the race that he had to bow out of. They make these types of increasing government dependency programs very popular with voters by talking about things like food deserts in cities. They're going to have fair food distribution. They're going to have all green tech schools. And the Robin Hood Foundation has simply driven the middle class, what was left of the middle class, out of New York City. Growing the activist base, I'm just going to flip over that because I'll just give you a few examples. The Center for Community Change and People for the American Way, and ACORN, I think most people have heard of ACORN. I have some copies of Matthew Badham's book about ACORN over there for sale. We can get Matthew Badham down here sometime next year. He visits me and my husband regularly, so I want to set up some speeches for him the next time he's here. He's the person who helped expose ACORN. The Sierra Club and the Ella Baker Center, these are the groups that were used to train people like me in the mid-90s. And People for the American Way was the primary one. They led that effort to create these silos of activists. They are now working with prominent Republicans and libertarians on some empty the prison efforts. Most of Soros' radical work is done through something called refunding. And refunders are a way to use the nonprofit system so that you can't trace the money. So if you get, say, 10 millionaires together, and we do it too, we have our own refunders on the right, you get 10 people, I think at least 10 people, to put $1 million or more each into something, and then it can become the type of nonprofit entity where you cannot trace the money anymore. This is how they paid for the Occupy movement. This is how they paid for things like the Ruckus Society, which actually is a terrorist group that was planning on attacking the Republican convention in Tampa. And this is how they pay for, I mean, there's been some news that's come out today thanks to James O'Keefe, because he's done a story on this, and he's got a very good story out right now, where they're showing the coordination with the DNC of these people who are attacking people at Trump rallies and trying to incite, you know, by acts of violence they can blame on Trump supporters. I don't know how many of you have been to a Trump rally in Georgia. I went down to the one at the Fox, and I dressed all in black, which I do anyway, but I'm Italian, so it's just like second nature. But I mingled with the protesters, and it was funny because I knew a lot of these people from back when I was, when I was on their side, even though I was always pro-police. Back in the early 90s, I saw the head of the ACLU, and I saw the head of the Human Rights Commission, and she was actually, this was the big gay organization, she was actually outside using her telephone to tell different groups of people who'd gotten into the Fox Theater when to jump up and disrupt the speeches. And I stood behind her and I taped her doing this. And then she saw me and she just took off running. But it really is very, very scary stuff that they're doing, and I encourage you to go home and watch the James O'Keefe reports, because it is coordinated chaos, and they were storming. These people had gotten a whole bunch of crazy homeless people, and they pay for the crazy homeless people to be there. They'll give them a sandwich or they give them some money, and I watched these people for hours, and they tried one thing after another to get into the Fox Theater. They got different groups of people into the Fox Theater who would jump up and disrupt every few minutes. And it's really quite frightening because it creates an environment where it's just going to take one person to be startled or get hurt or fight back or react. And they don't send one person in to sit there and jump up and yell. They've always got groups of 3 or 5 or 10 so that they can be videotaping while they create an incident just in case somebody gets hurt. Outside the building, it was mass war on the streets. It was people banging those stupid drums, and I don't know how police officers put up with this stuff, honestly. I just don't. Because they were spitting in their faces, they were screaming at them, not for a few minutes, but for hours, for the entire time that the Trump rally was going on. And they did it before the Trump rally happened, and they targeted the people going in, and then they were there to target them coming out again. And it was only because we had hundreds of police officers that we have to pay for, you know, extra time and all of that, that there wasn't violence. And they're doing this at every Trump rally in the United States, and it's very, very scary stuff. So Soros is funding it, but he's doing it through his refunder organizations. And so you can't trace the money back directly most of the time. Okay, we'll just go past this. I mentioned a little bit before about how he's really helped take over the universities. He's started funding these different groups at different universities. The one that I'm very interested in is John Jay College for Criminal Justice and Journalism. John Jay College used to be the cops' college. In New York City, I don't know if anybody here is from New York City, but if you were a cop and your dad was a fireman, or you were going to be an EMT and you were going to get a degree, you went to John Jay. And John Jay was known as a friendly place. You know about this?
I'm from New York, so I know about it.
Yeah. It was the place where we provided higher education for the people who were putting themselves on the front lines to protect us. Soros specifically targeted John Jay College, and it is now a hostile place for police. And the police officers I know, have spoken to me about this, and it's a loss of a tremendous resource. It's also very frightening because this was the premier criminal justice journalism program in the United States. And so now it went from being something where police officers' voices were actually being heard, and police officers who decided they wanted to go into journalism or wanted to pursue higher education and become teachers would go to that program. And it is now a program that is rapidly anti-police. Taking over the curriculum, I was a college instructor in Florida and Georgia. I matriculated from Emory University. By the time my politics were known, I was asked to leave the Women's Studies Department and finish my teaching in the English Department. I agreed to do that. And so I had a very unprofitable career as a composition teacher here and there at Emory and also a community college in Florida. But I do a lot of curriculum research, and I know you guys have had Judy Kraft and her husband here, and they're just absolutely magical people. And they're wonderful people who've done such good work on the curriculum in Georgia. But these are all organizations that Soros has funded. He puts a lot of money into PBS teachers. PBS teachers is used by 88% of the K-12 teachers in the United States. Okay, and I had a report with Mary Graybar you might want to take a look at, which shows you some of the lesson plans that are being taught in schools, all public, private, even conservative. Teachers use these materials. And then StoryCorps, Teaching for Change, Facing History and Ourselves, that's just some other groups that they've used to infiltrate academia. All the more media, quite obviously Soros funds these, Pacifica News and PBS. He funds a good bit of the Sundance Foundation, the Prohibition documentary that got a lot of people excited a long time ago, and really misrepresented the history of Prohibition, I think, as somebody who actually knows about the early 20th century. He funds books like The New Jim Crow, which are being widely assigned to students in schools. This is the propaganda that comes out of his organizations is extraordinary. And then the law on police as well, and I'll take questions, because I think people want to talk about the election. He funded Occupy Wall Street. He's funding Black Lives Matter. He's doing it through dozens of different organizations. And the goal is to demoralize police, roll back the policing methods that were actually saving lives in the early 90s, and also turn the public at large against the police. And we are in the middle of a war on cops. There was just another assassination attempt with police yesterday. I talk to police in Chicago on a regular basis. I talk to police in Boston on a regular basis. I know some police in New York City. They're not just afraid of going out into the streets. They're afraid of their bosses, okay? They're afraid of the American public. They're afraid of, I've had so many police officers say to me, because I used to blog about crime every day, I've had so many police officers say to me, my dad was a police officer, my grandfather was a police officer, my uncle was a police officer, I've told my children there's no way they're going to be a police officer. They are so far down in Chicago in terms of the number of new recruits that, and there are so many, the Department of Justice has put so many restrictions on what police can do in Chicago, that Chicago has actually, in a few years, managed to do something that nobody thought it would ever happen in America again. Okay, they've gone back to their 1991 crime rates. And there are dozens of shootings, and dozens of shootings every week there, and there are several murders every week. And they're exceeding the statistics from the 90s. Why would somebody do this? Because this is a revolution. So these are just some of the organizations. We'll go on because I think I'd like to actually hear from some stuff from you guys. We can skip this. And this is America's Survival, the Soros Files. You can get more information from there. And I also, of course, highly recommend David Horowitz's website, Discover the Networks. And there's a brochure on each of these pages with America's Survival information on it. So. I do want to say one more personal thing. Our latest production up in American Survival is Marxist Madrasis. Cliff Kincaid, who many of you may follow or know or have heard of from his, he's been a journalist for over 30 years. He was recently banned from a college campus at New Paltz. He's a conservative, and he had been doing a back and forth debate a couple times a year with the liberal. And they had been doing this for, 10 years together. He was on his way to New Paltz University a couple of months ago, and they called him on the plane and said, "Don't come, you're not welcome on campus." He was banned from campus because of he was going to cause trigger warnings among the students because of his political views. He managed to embarrass the, so we wrote this booklet about it, and we've got some over here for sale. He managed to embarrass the administration enough where they invited him back to speak. But the original person he'd been traveling around and doing this with, who he'd become friendly with, is too afraid to do this with him anymore. And the school recently hired a psychologist to explain to students the feelings they might have when Cliff comes in to speak at the school next week. And so they're offering psychological counseling to the students in case they are exposed to his ideas.
Snowflakes.
These people are beyond snowflakes, and I think snowflakes are sturdier than these folks. I think what Soros has accomplished is what I call the grad schoolification of America. When I went to graduate school, I was totally unprepared for what happened to me there. I thought I'd be going someplace and I'd be learning things, and I'd be doing scholarship and research, and if I disagreed with people, I was writing about public policy, then we would have viewpoints and research them. That had happened in my undergraduate school. My teachers might have been hippies, but they were hippies who'd been trained a generation earlier, and they were good teachers. When I got to Emory University, I looked around me, and it seemed like an insane asylum. I mean the humanities department. I mean, of course, they still do wonderful work. The law school, too. But the medical school, the research they're doing, the CDC, it's all that, people still are doing things in schools like Georgia Tech and Emory. But you can forget about the history department. You can forget about the English department. And I have spoken, when I was in Florida, I had so many retired teachers come to my presentations on the Soros Files. And they were retired teachers and social workers, and they were saying, nobody has any idea what's going on in the schools. Not even when you read about it every day and you hear about the real crazy people. I used to call it the 1,000-mile stare. I would have students transfer into my composition class because I taught composition. And the other class selections at Emory were, Chicana, lesbian literature, feminist politics and writing. And I taught, poetry, prose, rhetoric. And by the time these kids had gotten through orientation, they were numb. But they knew that they had 4 years ahead of them in that school. And they knew that their families had largely sacrificed a great deal to get them there. And they knew that if they crossed that teacher in their freshman composition class, that they might not become a doctor or a lawyer or a researcher or anything else they were there to do at great personal expense and family expense. And so we have really lost the universities. Since that time, since I was at Emory University, I feel like the rest of America is catching this disease. And I personally predict in this book that we are going to see hate speech laws like they have in Britain within the next couple of years. I mean, if we lose this election, hate speech laws are one of the first things on the agenda, okay? And once there are hate speech laws, what we're doing in this room is going to be illegal. So I hope that, I think all of you people were educated about Soros before you came into the room tonight to hear me carry on and on and on about him. But I wanted to give you just one more good fear before the election, because we have lost, University of North Georgia, you'd think it'd be a very conservative place. You should see their English department. Yeah, it's not. Yeah, I was invited to teach a special class there on James Dickey and cartography when I first got up here. We were going to do this really fun thing and go to the places where James Dickey's poems had been written in North Georgia, because one of my useful degrees is in poetry. And this woman found out about me and found out I was there and invited me to come and speak with her, and we were going to set up this wonderful course between the English department and the cartography school that they have at North Georgia. And at the end of our Starbucks coffee, she said to me, well, I hope you can stand living here because, you know, these tea party people are all over the place. And I said, funny you should say that, because I'll be speaking at the tea party meeting across the street tomorrow night. And she never called me back. So, you know, even at a place like North Georgia, where you would think it's a military school, it's in the most conservative part of the country, it's not. We've lost the schools, and we've lost the K-12 schools too. So we really have to fight like we've never fought before to win this election. I know Trump's problems, you know, God bless him. I grew up in New York City, in New York State. You know, every day my dad would come home from work with the Daily News and the New York Post, you know, so we could sit and read the sports scores. And we all followed what Trump did then. I know what the guy is about. But if we don't get this guy into office, the grad schoolification of America is going to be like nothing you've seen before. So I'm happy to address anything we've talked about here or anything else you guys would like to ask me. First Mike Scupine and then the gentleman there.
In your research, have you discovered any links between Soros and the National Popular Vote movement?
That's a really good question. And that's a question that I'd like to hear about some more from you guys, because I just recently heard about it. And I suddenly started hearing about it from everyone. Do people know what the National Vote Movement is? They're trying to do away with the Electoral College. And this is another one of those movements that just came out of nowhere. And it's the one person, one vote for the presidential election movement. Am I representing it right? Because I really haven't had time to look at it too much.
Yeah, that's pretty much what it is. It's going to change right now. Well, let's not get into the discussion on it right now, but I'm finding articles that say that he is involved heavily in it. I also went to a meeting that was sponsored by the people that are pushing the National Popular Vote. They say that he is not.
Well, they can say whatever they want. I mean, if it's any one of the thousands of organizations he funds, we can easily trace it back through, unless it's one of the refunders, and we can't.
So just in your presentation, it sounds like it would be right up his alley.
Here's my concern about the National Vote Movement, and this is also a concern I've had about the Convention of States to a degree, not to this degree, but to a degree. These are things that, when I see something come out of nowhere, and all of a sudden, I'm seeing it pop up all over the place. I know there's a coordinated campaign behind it. And this movement is targeting both liberals and conservatives. It's targeting the Tea Party, and it's targeting the progressive left. Okay? So this is something very frightening that I'm seeing happening more and more. This is happening with the Empty the Prisons movement. This is happening with Ban the Box. This is happening with rolling back recidivist sentencing. There are coalitions being formed between Soros and primarily libertarian organizations on the right that are working together on the open borders issue, the legalizing drugs issue, and the war on police, and the empty the prisons. And I'm terribly concerned about this. And so when I first heard about that movement, I said, I need to know more about that, because things are popping up in left-wing publications and right-wing publications at the same time, and they're both positive. This gentleman was first, and I'll come to you. I'm sorry.
What kind of infiltration are you seeing of Soros into our U.S. military branches?
That's something that I can't really speak to. I don't do security issues. However, if you do go to Accuracy and Media website, you will find some in-depth reports on that by people with that kind of knowledge. And if you have anything to bring to the table, please let us know. Sir?
I actually spent all day today researching George Soros and the National Popular Vote Movement.
Oh, did you? Well, then we have the answer here.
Well, I couldn't find really where he had put money in, but I found that a lot of the groups, the open society groups especially, where his name is on, have been funding the National Popular Vote
Movement. Well, then he's funding it. I mean, that is him funding it. I mean, it, people can say, oh, you know, people can say, oh, Soros isn't doing this or Soros isn't doing that. Well, if Soros runs the organization and pays for it, Soros is doing it. So, but I am seeing some groups on the right getting very caught up in this as well, and I'm very concerned about it. And it's worrying to me.
One of the strongest links I came across was Jonathan Soros wrote an article in favor of it in the Wall Street Journal.
And it was titled, How to Get Rid of the Electoral College. That was the subtitle of the Wall Street Journal.
Yeah, like I said, I haven't, I just recently spent 6 weeks without the internet because I moved onto a farm thinking that I would become a farmer. and I'm ready to pave it and turn it into a Walmart. I didn't know that coyotes actually really existed in real life, and and I saw a bear in the woods, and so I don't go outside anymore. So I'm actually a little bit behind the curve on recent stuff like this, but I think we need to keep an eye on this because this has been popping up everywhere.
When I looked at your presentation, one of the things I thought about was the 1963 goals of the American Communist Manifesto. And so have you found any linkage between, I mean, is he a communist, or what's the linkage between those 43 goals and some of the stuff that you've researched in Soros and his whole web of...
That's a good question. He definitely works with the communists. He works with them. However, his philosophy, Soros wants to replace governments with unelected, unappointed intellectuals and nonprofit people. And one of the things that that open society philosophy that he claims to stand by represents is that they're not communist, they're not Marxist. They want to give power to the people. Well, they don't really want to give power to the people. They want to, you know. He actually took advantage of the retreat of the Soviet Union from Eastern Europe to set up base there for himself. So he has a very complicated and political view of communism itself. He would say he's not a communist. Obviously, he's one of the biggest financiers in the entire world. But what he supports is making government weaker. And like I said at the beginning, that's something that we all would like to see. We'd like to see government stay local. We'd like to see government stay small and accessible. But the way he wants to make government weaker is to damage our borders, remove our ability to control our own laws, and replace all of those systems, like borders and laws, with experts funded by people like him who will have the power. So he's basically trying to disenfranchise us, which is what happens in communist states too. It's central planning. It's central planning by another name. It's a complicated relationship, but it is one, definitely.
Has he actually floated the idea of a one world order?
Oh yes, he speaks openly about one world order. I mean, this is not something that we made up. I mean, the Agenda 21 stuff all comes from his cohort. You know, this is something that when it began to be unpopular, when people began to say, wait, this one world order sounds a little bit like weirdly ominous and it's almost like a science fiction movie, then they began to change the way that they spoke about it. But 20 years ago, he openly spoke about looking forward to a one world order.
Who are Soros' like main lieutenants since he's like 86 years old when he dies?
His children will take over the organization, and Ari Nair is still there. Not Ari Nair. God, I always have name aphasia, but don't ask me for names. The person who's in charge of the foundation right now is going to stay in charge probably. He's the British criminologist whose last name is Cook, and who's the third person who's still advising them? I can't remember the name of the third person who's still advising them, but it is going to be run technically by his sons. And it already is largely being run by his sons. I mean, he's 86. He may have a new wife again, I don't know. But they've been working with him on this for years, and the ACLU provides a lot of their top, a lot of the top leadership within the Open Society Foundations in the United States.
There was a gentleman in 1858, his name was Norman Maton Thomas. I lost him, somehow disappeared off my cell phone. He ran for President of the United States as a socialist 6 times. Finally, towards the end of it in 1944, he says, "I'm no longer a socialist, I am a democratic person." He says, "Because the Democratic Party is a socialist party. Therefore, they have taken over, they have accepted my way of being a socialist," whatever it was. I lost them on here, and I don't know what happened. But that's what happened. So, and all these years, this is the closest the socialist party has come to taking over this country. And that's what we got to be aware of and be afraid of and be prepared. I had a lot I was going to bring this evening, but I didn't really know how to bring all of it out. But if you don't wake up and realize that this country is in so much serious problems right now, you can't even begin to imagine what's going to happen. So we have to be prepared and realize that this government, right from the president on down, is stealing our country. So I don't know how I can do so much, I can say so much, but we need help. Somehow we got all band together and become a nation again. We've gotten slack, and we've gotten soft, and we've been treated very nicely over the years, and now it's coming to fruition that we're in serious trouble. The President of the United States can declare martial law anytime he wants it on the LV-3601 something, I don't know what, I don't remember the number. And so if everything doesn't go his way, then you're going to see major riots throughout the United States, and he's going to declare, my personal opinion, he'll declare martial law and stay in office till they get what they want. And eventually he'll go off somewhere, I don't know what he'll do, but. So these are major problems, and I don't really know how to address all of it. I got a lot of things that I like to address. But I don't, you know, I called Trump, I sent money in, I sent the email, and I said, please call me, I need, you know, and he has not returned my call. So I don't know whether it's because the people that are around him don't want him to know stuff or what, but I like the man. I found that he would be the best choice for us, but I don't know how to get to him.
I have a suggestion, and I work with Trevor Loudon, and he was just up, he was just blowing through here because he was doing 60 cities in 60 days again, like a lunatic. And he is the person who documents communists and socialists in the U.S. government, state governments, local governments, and then, of course, the federal government. And he, unfortunately, has had, Mike, have you gotten your video yet?
No, I have not gotten it.
Okay. I just talked to him, he's got a new film out, which we showed it up right up the road in Cumming a couple weeks ago, and people purchased it, and they were supposed to have the film by now. It turns out that the film production company in Georgia is the problem. I just talked to the, just before I came in here today, I talked to the film's editor, and he's in a state of despair. Trevor's in a state of despair. They're desperately trying to get copies of this movie out to people so they can watch it before the election. Because Trevor does the hard work of documenting where the communists have, you know, who has communist ties, even within our country, within our local state legislature. He knew that Nan Orrock, my state representative in downtown Atlanta, was a former Communist Party USA member. I knew that, he knew that, he was in New Zealand. During our first conversation, he brought it up. He asked me what my zip code was. I told him what it was. He said, "Nan Orrock is your representative?" I said, "Yes." He said, "You know she's a communist, right?" And I said, "Well, I know that, and she knows that. And apparently this crazy guy in New Zealand knows that, but nobody else in my neighborhood of 20 years would believe me if I told them that." We have to start talking about communism again, and that's where Trevor actually comes, it does an excellent job. And he's very apologetic to anyone who's purchased the film and hasn't gotten it. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna triage, and they're gonna ship me some films as quickly as possible, and I will get them out to the leaders of Tea Party groups so you folks can watch this wonderful film in the next 2 weeks. And I'm terribly sorry that there's been this problem with distribution, but it's not Trevor and it's not the production company. It's not the editors, it's actually the person in Georgia who's producing the DVDs. So you guys have my I've got cards over there. If anybody would like to try to get a copy of the film to show to a group, not for yourselves, but to show to a group, or maybe I'm getting one from Mike if he can't get it quickly enough. And I highly encourage you to watch this before the, get together and watch this before the election. Okay? Even in house parties, pass it around. And I'll see about getting copies as quickly as possible because there is some problem with the production company. Okay, could I get him first and then?
Well, I'll talk to that.
How much money has Soros given the Clintons? I'll talk to
him. I don't know.
Does anybody know?
I would not be able to answer that question because he doesn't directly, it's not just what he would directly give to them, it's all of the organizations he has working for them. Billions. I just say billions because every single one of those hundreds of organizations is doing something to advance their agenda.
Is some of this stuff illegal, or is it any legal?
You know,
there's a racket, maybe racketeering, or is there?
I don't believe in the nonprofit industry anymore in general. Universities, even the state school ones, are such bastions of privilege and wastes of money that they've lost their original mission of teaching people how to have jobs and educating them. And I think that a lot of the blame for this lies at the feet of our nonprofit, you know. I mean, we would have to give up our nonprofits as well, but if I could wave a magic wand, I would do away with nonprofits. Because then we'd be on a level playing field again with the left to a large degree. And we just don't have the same type of infrastructure on this side for real grassroots activism. And we don't have, you know, we're not spending our money that way on this side. I don't think the right does a very good job. I've been on the left and I've been on the right. And I don't think the right does a very good job of bottoms-up grassroots organizing. I think we have a lot of money that's sitting in Washington and going to, you know, and going and staying at the top. And we don't have people at the bottom knowing how to, I mean, the Tea Party movement is extraordinary. Against all odds, the people in this room managed to do something that if it was done on the left, every single one of you guys would have a full-time paying job and a pension from, mostly paid for by the taxpayers. Because when I was sitting in those rooms with people for the American Way, the vast majority of people who were sitting at those tables with me were public employees. Okay? So that's how we lost America. And so I would say trash can the entire idea of nonprofits. And that goes for churches too. We just have to learn to live differently. But of course that's a pipe dream. But no, it's completely legal. Gentlemen.
Email after email after email. We need money. Nancy Pelosi's got so much money. The Democrats are buying all the ads and we don't have any money. Does anybody know the truth of that?
Well, they spend a lot more money than we do. When it comes to elections, it tends to be pretty even, but they found it to be much more productive to, you know, to spend money through these different organizations. And of course, when they win a cause, they, you know, every time a leftist wins a cause, a new public job is born. And so then a new leftist activist gets the money to keep being an activist. And every time we win a cause, there's one more person on our side who isn't employed in some type of industry in a lot of ways because we are asking to make the government smaller. So, you know, we're up against a structural problem here that's very hard to tackle. And I don't wanna, it's 8 o'clock, I think that's when you guys end your meetings. I'm happy to stay afterwards and talk to folks, and I'm happy to sell books over here. And I thank you very much for having me, and you'll see me again.
It's right behind Summits on Highway 9, where Keller Williams' offices are up on the hill.
Exactly, the lower part of the building. Thanks, faces Highway 9.
Yeah, can I speak to that? At this point, we're a few weeks from an election. We don't have time to do anything but work with the party, okay? The party is everywhere in the state. And we need to show up at, you are absolutely on mark. We need to show up at the office, and we don't have time to do anything but fight for Trump right now. So that's what you guys need to go do. Actually, the GOP in this state has stepped up. They heard us and they stepped up, and I'm very happy about that. So go work with the GOP and make the phone calls in their offices.
Oh, also, you guys,
what I was going to say, we're the counterweight to Soros. You're just saying the right is weak on grassroots because we can't hire the same number of people that they can. And that's where we're the tool. You all are the resources. We're just a tool that you all can use to fight back against Soros.
But AFP is partnering with Soros, okay? Yes, you are. AFP is partnering with Soros, and I'm very troubled by that. And I've been civil about it, but AFP is working with the Soros Foundations. They're working with the ACLU. They're working with Van Jones. And they are working to empty the prisons. So I'm sorry, but I say go work with the Republican Party.
That's fair. I mean, that's fine if that's your advice to them. I'm not going to argue about that.
I've got a couple over here. I got okay. Those things. Thank you.
Thanks.
Excuse me, Dan, I just have one final look. If you can't get to the GOP office, you go on the Donald J. Trump website and go to Trump Talk if you want to make calls to potential voters. So you have that way of doing it. You can do it from your home or wherever you are. So if you're away or whatever, you can still make calls to Trump voters. So you can do that as well. Thank you.
Did everybody hear him?
I'm sorry.
All right, thank you so much, Tina, and thank you, Tony West. Just a couple extra reminders. Again, she has her books over there for sale. I encourage everyone to purchase one or two. Also, Tony West with Americans for Prosperity is back there as well. You can talk to him. He's going to stay a little bit longer. Also, our drawing for the gun is December 13th, the Springfield 9mm. Y'all still have an opportunity to purchase raffle tickets tonight, if you like. And again, in November, our November meeting is going to be about our election and electing officers for the party. So if y'all are interested in running and coming in for vote, if you're a voting member, please do. We would highly encourage it. All right, thank you all for coming.
They want to script it, they want to, so we have Facebook, and email.